rocking it sharply. The man, struggling with the line, gave the dog a blow with one of the oars, which sent him into the other end of the boat, where he cringed, whimpering. Once more the man heaved his stout pole. Slowly it came to the surface, whatever it was. Tangled on the end of the line was a great clump of what looked like human hair. Shining in it was a bright golden barrette. As the man brought the object over the side of the boat, the dog let out a howl of terror and plunged into the lake, heading for shore. He soon made it and vanished into the woods. The man was amazed at the actions of the dog, but nevertheless decided to take the hair home and give the barrette to his wife. She could use it, he thought, to hold her hair back. The barrette was so entangled that they would have to hang the hair before the fire to dry it out to make the removal easier. His wife, though horrified at the idea, coveted the bright barrette and so consented. Long after the strands of hair were dry, the sound of dripping still could be heard. It went on all evening. Then, at the stroke of 12, a woman's voice came from the hanging strands. It told of her murder and how her body could be recovered. Then the voice faded away and was heard no more. The man and his wife couldn't believe what they'd heard and decided to keep it to themselves for the time being, particularly so that the wife could keep the valuable barrette. However, the dripping sound continued. It went on all night and all the next day, and the day after that. Finally, they could stand it no longer and reported their find to the authorities. Police dredged the lake and recovered the body, which was identified by the golden barrette. The dog never returned. He didn't even care to go after his dog. And I'm sorry, but you can get a whole pack of barrettes at Walgreens for like
$2. Must have been some diamond-studded one or something.
Must have been, but I don't ever want a barrette out of any dead woman's hair.
Sure?
Yeah. You can just get me one at the dollar store.
Okay. I can do that.
Okay. You want another?
Sure.
The man in the glove.
Oh, no!
It's okay. No worries.
Ugh. What is this called?
Post-it.
Oh, yeah, you told me that. Post-it. The man in the glove. While sightseeing in Scotland, a young American woman joined a group that was visiting an island where a crumbling castle had recently been opened to the public. As they approached the castle, the young lady noticed that a huge cloud overhead looked like a pair of boxing gloves. She called it to the attention of the others in the party, but thought no more about it. The unusual cloud formation soon faded away. Later that day, a sudden and violent storm came up. Because the trip back to the mainland was too rough for their small boat, the sightseers were forced to spend the night at the castle. The young American was given a room in one of the towers. She went to bed quite thrilled at the opportunity to spend the night there. Awakening during the night, she was surprised to see a pair of white gauntlets on the floor by her bed. The gloves were surrounded by a halo of light that illuminated the crest embroidered in red silk. As the bewildered woman raised her eyes from the strange sight, she was even more startled to see a tall, dark young man looking at her from the shadows beyond the gloves. At her gasp of terror, both the glowing gloves and the young man vanished. Perhaps, she thought, it had been a dream, inspired by the gauntlet-shaped cloud she had seen earlier. She didn't mention her ghostly visitor to anyone. Several years passed. In New York, she met a young Scotsman and married him. Shortly after their honeymoon, he received word that a maiden aunt had died in New England, and the newlyweds had to go there to close the house. It was very run down and dilapidated, with hardly a sign that it had been lived in. The young bride occupied herself by poking about the attic. There, in an old trunk, neatly wrapped in a bit of tarpon, was a pair of white gauntlets. Exactly the same as those she had seen in the castle years before. She hurried downstairs in excitement to show them to her husband and to tell him about the strange coincidence. When she held them out to him, he turned deathly pale. "So, my dear," he said, "you were the girl in the bed that night." Then he vanished. For the second time, his bride fainted, and when she came to, she was alone. Questioning the neighbors later, she was told that no one had lived in the old house for 100 years. She never saw her husband again. That's weird.
Yeah.
What's your project?
I don't know.
Somebody's messaging me. My sister, like about a month ago or something, asked me if I wanted to go to something with her and Evie. It was some dance and light thing, and I'm like, that sounds so stupid. No, I don't want to go.
What do you mean?
I know. I thought about it. I looked at the thing. I'm like, no, I really just don't. And so I said no. I feel good about saying no, but she just texted me because apparently she's at it right now. She asked my mom to go and she wouldn't go. She asked my dad to go. And then he said he'd go, but then she's like, no, I don't think you really want to go to this, so. But she just texted me to say she's at the intermission at that thing, and it's the trippiest thing she's ever seen in her life.
Maybe I would like that.
Well, I should have told her, well, why don't you call Brandon?
Yeah.
I'm sure he's free.
Right? Exactly.
You want me to read some more?
Yeah.
You want to talk for a while? These are short stories.
Yeah.
Which is good, right?
Yeah.
Can you hear if I start now?
Yeah.
The spell on the mirror. Wait, should I play in?
Mm-hmm.
Oh no, she's in. Okay, the spell on the mirror. In the War Memorial Hospital in St. Marie, Michigan, Jeffrey DeRossier was close to death. He knew he was critically ill, and so did the three other patients who shared the small ward. One afternoon, DeRossier asked the nurse to hand him the small mirror from the enamel table beside his bed. The nurse gave him the mirror, which was just a plain piece of silvered glass without a frame or handle. A moment later, he threw it back upon the bedside table and cried hysterically, "I'm dying!" The other patients watching him were stunned. He spoke again in a low, dull voice. "You won't be able to pick up that mirror," he said. Then he died. After his body had been removed, one of the other patients casually tried to pick up the mirror. He couldn't budge it from where it lay on the white table. Baffled, he asked the nurse to pick it up, but she couldn't move it either. A doctor was called, and he too tried to lift the mirror from its place. It would not move. It was just a ring. I don't know. Soon, word of the haunted mirror spread throughout the hospital. Nurses, interns, and curious patients all tried to move the little mirror from where the dying man had thrown it. No one succeeded. All day, the mirror defied every attempt to move it. Even when a nurse tried to pry it loose with an ice pick, it remained sealed to the tabletop. Then another nurse tried to work her fingernail under the edge of the little piece of glass. As if at that moment the spell was broken, the mirror flew several feet into the air and fell to the floor unbroken. At last it had moved. Trying to find a reason for the mirror sticking to the table as long as it had, some of the witnesses attempted to make it stick again, but they couldn't do it. There was no adhesive on the back of the piece of silver glass, and anyone could now pick it up easily from the dry tabletop. They wet the surface in an attempt to create a suction so that the mirror would stick once more, but the spell was broken. Later, the mirror was cracked, perhaps on purpose, and thrown away. There was never any explanation of the spell cast by Geoffrey de Rosière's dying words. The end.
Weird.
Any hypothesis? Speculation of any sort?
Weird.
Alright.
Weird and wild.
Some weird wild stuff, babe. Should I keep going?
Sure. If you want to.
I don't mind.
Okay.
As long as you're into Dustin and Jake Honeyman.
What? What?
Said don't spill your drink, you were up against it first.
Oh. Is it open yet?
No. Okay, the Iron Tomahawk. This weird incident took place recently in northern Vermont, near the Canadian line, and its authenticity was sworn to by the farmer to whom it happened. This man had a dream. According to his story, when he was a very young boy,